And welcome to Catholic Answers Live for this Thursday. So happy to be with you. Tomorrow, broadcasting live from the Religious Ed Conference in Los Angeles. So please come by the Catholic Answers booth or the EWTN booth, depending. We'll be moving around a little bit and say hello. Topic today, open forum. Open forum means any question that you might have on the life of the Catholic faith, on the Bible, on the history of religion, or the way the various religions worked, you know, may work in the world, or their philosophies. We'll take any of it today. We're happy to take any question, maybe on the moral life. Maybe you have a question about how moral philosophy works, or how you make hard decisions when they involve moral questions. We're happy to take those as well. 888-318-7884 is the number. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and joining us today as our guest both hours, Jimmy Akin. Hi, Jimmy.
Howdy. How you doing, Cy?
Well, I'm actually a little annoyed at myself as I'm making that introduction, realizing I'm not prepared with a daily defense. Every day that we've been...
Well, then I have this book that can help you out.
Well done, Jimmy.
Yeah, I have a book called A Daily Defense that could provide exactly that for you.
That's right. But unfortunately, it's not in front of me. It's over on the shelf behind you. And so usually we've been A Daily Defense, 365 days plus one
of defenses of either the Catholic faith specifically or the Christian faith in general, or even more broadly, just the concept of faith. Each page is an entry, takes maybe, I don't know, 4 minutes to read, something like that. And they're numbered, so you can read either one a day or as many as you want a day. And each one has a different challenge and then a response to that challenge. And because there are literally hundreds of topics in there, I guarantee there's going to be new and interesting stuff that people have not encountered before.
And I have found that myself, and that's why it's been fun to give you one, you
know, but as well as an occasionally, there's also will be an occasional surprise science fiction reference in there just for fun.
You are a big science fiction fan.
I am. Are
you?
Yeah.
You got a favorite science fiction movie of all time?
No. Someone was asking me that earlier today, but no.
Really? Second time today you've asked a question like that?
I have a favorite science fiction series of all time, but not movie.
Can I guess?
You can guess.
I don't know if I can guess, but Doctor Who?
No, I like Doctor Who, but it's not my all-time favorite.
Go ahead.
My all-time favorite would be Star Trek Deep Space Nine, the best of the Star Treks.
You know, from earlier conversations, I knew that was your favorite of the Star Treks, but I didn't know it was your favorite science fiction
series
of all time.
Yeah. It can be tough, you know, to make decisions like that.
Yeah.
I mean, you were mentioning earlier in the show, sometimes we have tough moral decisions and they can be really difficult to decide. You have all these factors to weigh, and sometimes it seems like no matter what you choose, a whale is going to die. So it just happens.
Do you think that listeners will get that reference, or do you say that on the?
Some of them will.
There are some people who will get that reference.
Some will, some won't. I like to layer in little things. You don't need to know the reference to follow the conversation, but if you are one of the people who knows the reference, it adds a little special something.
Yeah. Right. Buddy system. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, there
you go. Did I say something out loud? Let me ask you this. As a Catholic apologist, well-versed in the faith. Okay, so you say you watch a television show that's one of these science fiction shows like Deep Space Nine. And often they don't answer moral questions in the way that maybe a Christian would, or a Catholic more specifically
there
would.
There is some of that. One of the things classically that science fiction does is it uses unusual situations to explore moral questions. And actually, science fiction is famous for doing that. And sometimes the answers they come to are quite Christian in their outcome. I won't spoil it, but for those who know, the movie Soylent Green is a classic example of what they find out in the movie Soylent Green goes directly to some very important moral issues.
Yeah.
And it has, even though it's a dystopian society where things are not going well and suicide is legal and stuff like that, it ends up painting a Christian moral vision by the end. Similarly, Planet of the Apes. I'm not going to spoil the ending of that either, but for those who know, which is most people, you know, there's a very powerful statement there as well about morality. And science fiction in general does that. There are exceptions where people make wrong moral choices and the series portrays it.
Right.
But it can also explore things in an interesting way. In the last season of Deep Space Nine, it's an alien world with an alien religion, but you have effectively the Pope of this alien religion slap a guy and call him a heretic, and the entire, now normally in a normal setting, if you saw that on the screen, it would be portrayed as the Pope is in the wrong.
Right.
And you're supposed to disapprove of what the Pope just did.
Right.
But in this science fiction setting, the way they've set up this story, actually the whole audience is cheering on the Pope.
Really?
And so it's a powerful scene. It's like, yeah, give it to that guy.
Yeah. I do remember reading some, like, it might have been Robert Heinlein, and where it doesn't just seem like he's exploring moral issues. It seems like he's taking moral positions that would be very difficult to be sympathetic with as a Christian.
Yeah. Well, and true, like in Starship Troopers. He has a very libertarian philosophy,
yeah,
and aspects of that are compatible with the Christian faith, but also some aspects aren't. And you know, when authors portray something, it doesn't necessarily mean they approve of it.
Right.
So, yeah, you know, we have to keep that in mind, too. My problem with Starship Troopers is you get to hear every single lecture the guy has all the way through Space Academy, and I got lectured out.
Yeah, maybe take one off.
Yeah.
Maybe just give us the highlights here or there. 888-318-7884 is the number. Open forum today on Catholic Answers Live. Open forum means any question you have, but it also means anyone can ask that question, whether you are Catholic or non-Catholic. We're happy to take that call. Jimmy Akin taking your questions today. Jimmy, maybe we'll just go straight to a call real quick before we have to take a break.
Sure thing.
James in Charleston, South Carolina, listening on Ave Maria Radio. James, you are on with Jimmy Akin.
Are you there, James?
Hi.
Hi, you're on the air. What's your question?
I've seen people touch the monstrance in adoration when they walk in,
okay,
the bottom of the monstrance. I was just wondering, is that proper?
Traditionally, the monstrance is, well, at least when it's being used to administer benediction to people, the priest uses a special kind of garment to hold the monstrance, and so I know when benediction is being done, you're supposed to use this special kind of liturgical vestment to do that. You're not supposed to. The priest isn't just directly touching it with his hands. Outside of that setting, I would have to check. So let me see what I can find out, and I'll try to report back later in the show.
We'll take a break then. Open forum here on Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin taking your calls. 888-318-7884 is the number, and we'll be right back.
This is Archbishop Paul Coakley, the Archdiocese of Oklahoma City, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
We as Catholics need to stand strong, to be prepared to mount a daily defense, to respond to the many challenges that we as believers are presented with every day. Jimmy Akin is here to help. His innovative new book, A Daily Defense, takes up a different challenge for every day of the year, 366 in all, teaching you how you can defend the faith and give answers to Catholics and skeptics alike. And it's user-friendly, with challenges and answers indexed alphabetically, so finding the answers can be quick and easy. Order your copy of A Daily Defense today by calling 1-888-291-8000. Visiting Catholic.com or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
St. Paul's street evangelization isn't like other evangelism you might have seen on the streets. We don't yell, and we don't force anyone to pay attention to us. Instead, St. Paul's street evangelization is committed to presenting a positive, passionately Catholic presence to a world hungry for truth. For more information, or to start a chapter of your own, go to www.streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com. It's time to do our part.
The Catholic Answers Minute. I'm Father Vincent Serpa. In Mark 9:41, Jesus spoke of the evil of scandalizing the innocent. It would be better to go without a hand or an eye than to let these parts of one's body be the agents of sin. To scandalize is to cause a moral lapse in another, enabling that person to sin. Jesus is most concerned that we not have a casual attitude about evil and sin. We need to recognize how and where our culture minimizes evil and rationalizes sinful behavior. The legalization of abortion is defended as giving women the right to choose, without acknowledging what that choice actually is. The sacred expression of mutual self-donation in the marital act is pulled out of context and reduced to a matter of recreational pleasure to be taken wherever and whenever one can get it. Life is a gift, and every one of us owes the author of this gift an account of how honest and responsible we have been with it. I'm Father Vincent Serpa for Catholic Answers, Catholic.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Jimmy Akin, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers, is our guest this hour. Our topic is an open forum, so you pick the topic, anything that's on your mind. And James had asked before about touching the monstrance.
Yeah, and I wanted to just check because, you know, I have a fallible memory like everybody else, but I wanted to just check, which I was able to do during the break. And as I indicated, this special garment, which is known as a humeral veil, is used to hold the monstrance during benediction. That's when the priest picks up the monstrance and makes the sign of the cross and blesses the people who are in attendance. But in other circumstances, the humeral veil is not required. And so priests and other people can and do touch the monstrance without any special garments or anything like that when it's appropriate. Now, obviously, you know, you're doing that in a respectful way and, you know, you're not doing it excessively or unnecessarily, but but it's there is no special requirement that says only a priest can touch the monstrance or only someone using a humeral veil can touch the monstrance. So that's my understanding at the present.
I noticed usually in adoration and whatnot, it's not in a position where it would be convenient to touch. Like, it would be walk up to the altar.
It's going
to
depend on I guess on how, like, if it's a special adoration chapel, those vary widely in how they're set up in parishes.
Ah, yeah. Okay. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. Open forum today on Catholic Answers Live. We go now to Anonymous in St. Louis, Missouri, listening on Sirius Satellite Radio to EWTN. Anonymous, you are on with Jimmy Akin.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Love your show. I'll talk real fast, then I get a lot of callers. I'll try and set this up. But I am Catholic, and, you know, we're all sinners, but so no one's perfect. But I have the parish that I belong to accepted about a year ago a transgender individual into the church, which I, from what I understand, it's acceptable as long as they acknowledge their sins and they move forward, acknowledging that their past life was a sinful lifestyle and they can move forward. However, my concern is, and I guess my question is what is the church's position, and should I talk to the priest? Because I think the individual, I've heard through comments, thinks that the church just fully accepts the lifestyle, and I don't think that's correct. I'm a little confused, and I would love some guidance on that.
Okay, well, I'm a little confused, too, because when people say transgender individual, they can mean a bunch of different things. So I need a little more clarity in this case. What do you mean when you say this person is a transgender individual? I mean, have they had sexual reassignment surgery or what?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, this person used to be a male and is now a female.
Anatomically.
What I understand. I don't know them closely, but that's what I understand.
Okay. So the person is anatomically female. There's this, assuming we're not talking about one of the unusual cases where someone is born, you know, like with two sets of anatomy and a choice has to be made. I mean, that's a separate case. So the person would actually really be a male who's been surgically altered to appear female anatomically. And has the person repented of this act of getting surgically altered in this way, or have they not?
Well, and that's my concern, is that, what I understand they have. I'm pretty involved with the parish. I know it's really kind of none of my business, other than the fact that I'm concerned after hearing some statements that they're kind of making a mockery of the Catholic faith, and it is my parish.
Right.
And from what I understand, to get to the point they got where they were confirmed as a Catholic, that they had to go through the process, and they did repent. You know, I've been told
Good.
That. But you know, just recently, over the last week, I just kind of overheard them talking about that the church accepts the lifestyle, and I'm just concerned for them. I don't know if I should just pray for them, or should I address it with my priest, or just, you know, just pray for them.
It's a judgment call, is the bottom line answer. There's no single answer here, because, it sounds like the person did what they needed to do, which was repent. Now, there are other questions that follow on from that in this situation, like, where do you go from here? But it sounds like the fundamental criterion of repentance was met, and so the person, you know, could be confirmed in the church, and that's good. Sometimes when people convert, they later have doubts about various things or misimpressions, and so the person may have a misimpression about what the church's teaching is in this area that may have generated some doubts. They may have been told some erroneous things even after they were confirmed that have misled them into thinking, well, it doesn't matter at all on this issue, that there's no moral issue here. On the other hand, if it's just you've overheard a comment, especially out of context, you don't want to go off half-cocked, because this person, whoever they are, has the same right to a good reputation that you do. And so I always advise people to apply the golden rule. That generally means several things. Number one, it means you don't automatically start by reporting people behind their back, because nobody likes it when that's done to them. And so I suggest that not be your first option here. What I would do if I heard somebody expressing a sentiment that was out of harmony with the church's teachings, I would first, pray for the person. And also, I would check myself and say, could I have misunderstood this in some way? Or could they have misspoken? Or is there a more charitable interpretation here that would be in line with the church's teaching? Because I don't want a misunderstanding on my part, or simply a misstatement on their part, like forgetting to use the word not, when they should have used the word not. I wouldn't want a situation like that to cause a big problem. And I would then say, okay, what's my relationship with this person, and is there a way that I can be of service to this person? Am I in a position to help them out myself, such as by going to them and saying, I thought I heard you say this, and I wasn't sure what you meant by that, because my understanding is this, maybe you could help me out. Maybe you could clarify what I thought you heard you say, and we can reach agreement and be of one mind on this. Or, if you have a different view, maybe you could present me with evidence for your view, and we can talk about it. But I would be inclined to start, if you deem it you're in a position to talk to this person and to help this person, I would start with the person himself, because that's what I would want. If someone heard me say something that they thought was problematic, I would want them to talk to me and not immediately start reporting me to somebody else. Also, that's what our Lord recommends in Matthew chapter 18. Now, in that case, he's addressing if someone has sinned against you, but the same principle applies, because if it applies even when someone has sinned against you directly, that you want to start with that person, it applies even more when the person hasn't sinned against you directly. You've just overheard something. And so I would say, think about the situation, think about how you can be of best help to this person, and then your first recourse, if you decide to move forward, I would say talk to the person directly and get some more clarity.
Thank you very much, Anonymous. We now go to Tony in Los Alamitos, California, listening on Immaculate Heart Radio. Tony, you are on with Jimmy Akin. What's your question?
Yes, I have a question on Genesis 2:8, and my question is, how should we understand / interpret the footnote for this verse of God planted a garden in Eden?
Uh-huh.
The footnote that I'm reading online at the USCCB, I'm assuming is the NAB translation.
Right. This should be the New American Bible Revised Edition, the NABRE. Uh-huh.
Yes. And so it states there within the footnote for Genesis 2:8 that one of the translations, the Greek translation, is that God planted a paradise equals pleasure park in
Eden.
Uh-huh.
Right.
And it goes on to talk about how, this pleasure park was a pleasure park for God, not a paradise for the human race.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it almost sounds like we should interpret this kind of like a primordial amusement park that God created with all its creatures, and almost like an island of Dr. Moreau kind of thing.
Ooh.
Is that correct?
Whoa.
There's some science fiction.
Are we not men? okay, well, I wouldn't characterize it as the island of Dr. Moreau. That's a famous science fiction story by H.G. Wells. And Dr. Moreau experiments with human-animal hybrids there, and it's kind of sinister. This is something different. There's an element of truth here, though. As you know, God is frequently depicted in Scripture as a king, as a monarch. Kings were very common in the ancient world. They were the standard leader that any given nation would have. It would have a king. And so it was natural, since God is in charge of everything, to depict him as if he's a king. And one of the things that kings had, and we see various ways that God is depicted as a king, not just by being called a king, but also if you look at different passages in the Old Testament, God has a heavenly court. So he has messengers, just like a regular king. That's what the angels are. The word for angel means messenger. Similarly, he has court officials like the prosecutor or the accuser or the Satan, because that's what Satan means, is adversary or accuser. He's the equivalent of the prosecutor in the heavenly court, which is why in the book of Job, he has access to God in heaven and says, "Have you seen Job?" And he accuses Job. That's another illustration. Also, God obviously has a throne, and he has a footstool, and he has all of these different things that are associated with kings in the ancient world. Well, one of the things that was associated with a king in the ancient world is a paradise. A paradise is basically a kind of pleasure park. It's a kind of park that kings would have for their pleasure. It would typically be beautiful. It would have beautiful plants. It might have game there. It might be a hunting park where the king could engage in hunting if that was one of his hobbies. And there would be people who maintained the paradise for the king. It would often be built, you know, kind of alongside the king's residence, so he had easy access to it. And there would be people who kept it up. You know, there would be a gardener who, like, cared for the plants. There would be wardens who would care for the livestock or the game in it, or who would make sure if fishing was done there, that the bodies of water were stocked with fish. And so amusement park has a kind of different connotation to us, and we're not really familiar with pleasure parks today. That's not a familiar term in English. But basically, it would be a place that of natural beauty and enjoyment that a ruler would arrange to have for himself. And that is kind of basically what Eden appears to be. The Garden of Eden appears to be is a paradise along the lines, because that term didn't originally mean state of bliss. It meant a place that a ruler would have like this. And so it appears that, you know, Adam, as the Gardener of Eden, is kind of God's caretaker for this place of natural beauty that God had built to enjoy. Now, there's a question about to what degree is this literal? Because obviously, like, God doesn't literally have a throne, you know, because he doesn't literally have a body apart from the incarnation. That's a symbol that Scripture uses to help us understand the majesty of God. And the Catechism says that Genesis uses some symbolism to convey these truths to us in the early chapters. And so there's a question of how literal this is. But nevertheless, that's the image that's being drawn upon by the sacred inspired author.
Open forum today on Catholic Answers Live. Thank you very much for that question, Tony. The island of Dr. Moreau terrified me when I was
Did
a kid.
It? Oh, wow.
Horrified me. More with Jimmy Akin when we come back.
Catholic Answers Live.
It may be true for you, but not for me. How often have you heard this during a discussion with friends or family? Whether talking about faith, morality, politics, or just the basic notion of truth, so many people are captive to the notion of relativism, the belief that reality is something we decide. In his new audio presentation, Your Truth, My Truth, a anthropologist Carlo Brassard breaks down this intellectual cancer, looking at the different kinds of relativism we regularly encounter and demonstrating how, ultimately, they collapse under the weight of their own incoherence. More importantly, Carlo makes a powerful case for the existence of objective truth, showing you how to explain to others that right and wrong are both real and universal, because it was designed that way by God. Order your copy of Your Truth, My Truth by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
How can you know for sure that God exists? If God is good, why is there so much evil in the world? Doesn't evolution mean we don't need God to explain human life? Why should I believe in God when religion is the number one cause of war, ignorance, and misery? In 20 Answers Atheism, you'll find smart, solid answers to these questions and many more, helping you to understand the main argument for and against God's existence, and giving you the knowledge you need to explain to others the reasonableness of belief. 20 Answers Atheism is part of the 20 Answers series from Catholic Answers, offering hard facts, powerful arguments, and clear explanations of the most important topics facing the Church and the world, all in a compact, easy-to-read package. Visit shop.catholic.com and take a look at this exciting new series from Catholic Answers Press.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. If you're going to be in Los Angeles at the Los Angeles Religious Education Congress this weekend, be sure to stop by the Catholic Answers booth. We're at booth number 275. We'll also be up there on Friday broadcasting Catholic Answers Live from the event. Come get your questions answered on Catholic Answers Live. The broadcast will be at the EWTN booth because they're all set up with the microphones and all that there. But we'll be happy to see you in either spot. 888-318-7884 is our number. That's 888-318-7884. Our topic, open forum. Anything that's on your mind, any question you've got about the life of faith, we're happy to take it today. We go to Nick in San Antonio, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio. Nick, you are on with Jimmy Akin.
Hey, how you doing?
Just fine.
Okay, so my question is in regards to the whole Amoris Laetitiae situation going on now in the Church.
Sure.
Let's just say, hypothetically, if the Pope were to come out and say, yes, I'm like, you know, I intend to change the doctrine for divorced and remarried Catholics to receive communion. What would that mean for the Church as a whole? Like, would this be a heretical teaching or, an erroneous teaching?
I'm not sure that this would involve a teaching at all. Now, there are, because there the teaching is that, I mean, there are several related teachings here. One of them is that people who are in a state of mortal sin should not receive communion. And another is that people who are not validly married to each other but who are having sexual relations are committing a grave sin. And if they do that with adequate knowledge and consent, it becomes a mortal sin. And there is a teaching that, so, you know, you have, those are teachings. Then there's also the fact that marriage is indissoluble, and so if you're validly, sacramentally married to one person and it's consummated, then you can't just get divorced and remarried to another person. So there are teachings there, but in terms of the Church's discipline regarding the distribution of communion, that's a separate thing. The Church can say you should not receive communion in this circumstance, but still allow people to receive it. There's a famous illustration of that involving two canons in the Code of Canon Law. One of them is Canon 915, which says that if someone is in a state of public grave sin, meaning mortal sin, and this is known, and they're obstinate in it, then the minister of communion is not to give them Holy Communion. So this creates a burden on the minister to withhold communion. But then there's Canon 916, which says that if you're in a state of mortal sin, I mean, I'm summarizing, I'm leaving out some qualifications, but in essence, if you're in a state of mortal sin, you should not present yourself for communion. But notice this, these two canons have a notable exception, which may not be quite the right way to put it, but consider this situation. Somebody has committed a mortal sin secretly, so it's not publicly known. So, well, under Canon 916, they shouldn't go receive communion. Suppose the priest has heard this person's confession and knows that they committed this sin, but they know it. The priest knows it under the seal of confession, and he knows the person hasn't really repented. So let's say he denied the person absolution. Well, because it's under the seal, he's not allowed to use that knowledge in any way against this person, including he can't deny them the sacrament of Holy Communion. And so Canon 915 does not apply because it's not in the external forum. It's not publicly known that this person is obstinately persisting in a grave sin because it's not a manifest grave sin. It's not publicly known. And so the church actually requires a priest in this situation to go ahead and administer communion to somebody even though he has every reason to believe this person is not in a state of grace. So obviously, even though the church is teaching doctrinally is that a person who's not in a state of grace should not go to communion, that doesn't translate in every case to the church's practice of saying a priest can never give communion to someone who he believes is not in a state of grace. And so consequently, I could imagine a scenario, and I'm not saying this is likely to happen, I'm not saying this should happen, I'm very far from saying anything like that, but to answer your question, what would it involve for the church in terms of doctrine and practice, and would there be heresy involved? I'm not sure that a doctrine would be engaged here if the Pope simply said, we're going to abolish Canon 915, and we're going to put the burden of whether you should go to communion entirely on you and not the minister. We're going to leave our doctrine the same. We're going to say that you shouldn't go to communion if you're in a state of grace. If you're not in a state of grace, we're going to say that marriage is indissoluble. We're going to say all of the things we need to say doctrinally, but we're now putting the burden of enforcing that entirely on the communicant and not on the minister. That wouldn't involve a heresy. It would just involve a change of the church's practice. And so, like I said, I'm not advocating that, I'm not predicting that, but I am saying that change of canon law would be a change of discipline, not of doctrine. So I hope that helps you out.
Oh. No, yes, that helps a lot. Thank you. Just so many people I've heard a lot of people say it's like, you know, if you were to come out and say that, they're going to leave the church and all this stuff. So it's just been stressing me out a lot, but this really helps a lot.
Good. Yeah. And that's why, because I know people are stressed about this. And so that's why I felt it's important to explain it in those terms. A lot of people are kind of letting their imaginations, you know, give them kind of nightmare scenarios. And, you know, we're not there. Trust God. You know, God is the one who's ultimately in charge. He's given us promises regarding his church, and we can be confident in him. And so don't freak out about what might or might not happen in the future. Just trust God and take it one day at a time. Like Jesus said, every day has its own trouble.
Thank you, Nick. We go now to Anonymous in Los Angeles, California, listening on Immaculate Heart Radio. Anonymous, you are on with Jimmy Akin. What's your question?
Hi, I was calling because I recently had a baby who happens to have Down syndrome.
Oh.
And yeah, he's fine, thank you. Mm-hmm. We've gotten past that, if you will. It was very hard at first, but I am also a breast cancer survivor.
Oh.
And I'm a little bit older.
Praise God that you survived.
Yes, thank you. Mm-hmm. And my dilemma, if you will, is that I asked my husband, after I had a conversation with God, mm-hmm. to have a vasectomy, because I really feel in my heart that mm-hmm. I mean, physically, emotionally, mm-hmm. and psychologically, I couldn't go through another pregnancy like I did with our third baby.
Right.
He just came out of the hospital. It's just really, really tough.
Yeah.
And, you know, now I pray extra hard that I don't have a recurrence because my other children are a little bit older, but now, heaven forbid, something should happen to me.
Right.
What, you know, who's going to take care of him? And I just want to know if I can continue going to confession. I mean, not confession, but if I can, well, I know I can go to confession, but if I can continue taking the Eucharist knowing that, you know, I just,
has your husband had the vasectomy yet?
He has, and we couldn't do natural family planning because chemo messed up my cycle, and I'm not a regular, mm-hmm. and, you know, I'm going in through menopause now, which chemo also is the culprit.
Right.
And it's just, I don't want to say that's the only option, but I feel that for health reasons, mm-hmm. it kind of was.
Okay. Here's what I can tell you. First thing is I want to extend my sympathy, and I know, Si, I'm sure you feel the same way. You've obviously gone through a lot. I mean,
yes.
We all have
right.
crosses in our lives, and some people have a lot of crosses. And really with all of us at various points in our life, you know, the weight of the crosses we carry can be heavy, and that's obviously been the case with you. So I just want to express sympathy and understanding for that. I also understand why you would not want to have more children at this point. If you're nearing menopause and you've already had one child who's a special needs child and you've had health problems, a new pregnancy would put additional stress on you and on everybody else. It could even lead to a recurrence of your breast cancer or of cancer of some form because, you know, cancer is related to a failure of the immune system to knock out those cancer cells when they're still early. And so the strain on your system could do that. And so pregnancy is a big strain. And so it's understandable that you would say, now is not the right time in my life to have another child. And it's also understandable that you would say, we need to use effective means to deal with that. So all of that is understandable. It's totally understandable that you would not say this is a good time to have a child and that you need to use effective means to do that. All of that's true. What is the problem is that in asking your husband to have a vasectomy, you are asking him to mutilate himself, to disable a function of his body that God designed him to have. And it and to do so in order to interfere with the way that God designed our reproduction to work. A better solution, one that would have been in harmony with God's will, would be to say we're going to respect the integrity of our bodies and we're going to work with his plan for human reproduction, which includes an intelligent discernment of when it's appropriate to have a child. We've discerned that now is not the time, and the best way to achieve that goal in harmony with God's plan would be to say, well, we're not going to have sexual relations for right now. You mentioned you're near menopause, and, you know, well, after you've experienced menopause, you won't have the possibility of having another child, and so you won't have that difficulty to work through in the future. You know, you'll have the ability. It's not like you're saying, well, we'll never be able to have sexual relations again. But if you aren't able to effectively use natural family planning in a particular situation because of an irregular cycle and the chemotherapy and so forth, then the logical thing to do would be to say, we're going to be patient, we're going to rely on God to give us the grace we need to get through this period, and then once we're through this period, we'll be able to resume more of a normal married life in that respect. So that's what would have been in keeping with working with God's plan for reproduction and for husbands and wives. Having arrived at this stage, I would say the thing to do for both you and your husband would be to say, you know, we made a mistake. We had good motives. We were trying to do the responsible thing, and we did, you know, we were pursuing a responsible goal given our situation of not having a child, but we did it in a way that we shouldn't have. And so we want to acknowledge that. We want to go to confession about it and then continue to receive the sacraments, including the Eucharist, but you do need to come to that point of recognizing that this should have been handled a different way, and you need to go to confession about that. So that's what I would recommend. I understand, my heart really goes out to you. I understand the difficulty of your situation, and the church understands the difficulty of your situation. And the thing to do is not to dwell overly on the past, but to learn from it and move forward in accordance with God's plan. And so I hope that helps.
Open Forum continues here on Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin, we got lots of calls lined up, but you can still get your call in because we're doing 2 hours of Open Forum today. 888-318-7884 is the number. But I do suggest you start dialing sometime soon to make sure we can get to you before the end of the program. Again, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett. We'll be right back.
Bringing you the truth. Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, my friends. This is Christopher Check, president of Catholic Answers, inviting you to join Tim Staples and me next summer, June 3rd to the 10th, as we sail from Montreal to Boston. Joining us also will be special guests, Patrick Madrid of Immaculate Heart Radio, and my brother, Father Paul Check. Catholic Answers has been the gold standard of Catholic cruising for over 15 years. This cruise will be the perfect blend of apologetics, church history, and spirituality as we talk about how to transform our land in Christ. We will explore some of North America's most magnificent churches, including the Shrine of St. Anne de Beaupré. We are also planning a special pre-cruise event in Montreal that will include a pilgrimage to the tomb of St. Kateri Tekakwitha, the Lily of the Mohawks. All of our cruises include daily mass, opportunities for confession, and the convivial company of fellow Catholics who share your love of the faith. Signups are brisk, so please don't delay registering. For all the details and to register, visit CatholicAnswersCruise.com. That's CatholicAnswersCruise.com.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their faith and values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
Hi, this is Trent Horn, and I'm challenging you to take the 20 Answers Challenge. Catholic Answers 20 Answers series offers hard facts, powerful arguments, and clear explanations of the most important topics facing the church and the world. Here's how the challenge works. When you purchase the sampler of all 20 books in the series, we're going to knock the price in half. And we're challenging you to finish them all this Lent and Easter season. Then, we're going to take $10 from each set purchased and provide materials to our friends at St. Paul Street Evangelization so they can do what they do best, hit the streets and share the Catholic faith. That's $10 from every set you purchase going to help our fellow workers in the vineyard. You win, St. Paul Street Evangelization wins, the Catholic Church wins. That's a win, win, win. Together, we can be part of something great. Call 1-888-291-8000 or visit the shop at Catholic.com to get your set and begin taking the 20 Answers Challenge today.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Senior apologist Jimmy Akin taking your calls today, and it's an open forum. That means whether you're Catholic or not, you're welcome to call. And whatever your question is on any aspect of the life of faith, we're happy to take those calls today. 888-318-7884. There seems to be an epidemic of anonymity going around.
Yeah.
So I will go to another anonymous caller. or there's a lot of people who have been named anonymous. I think that's much less likely. Anonymous in Morgantown, West Virginia, listening on WV. That can't be right. WVLOL?
That, yes. I'm LOLing.
Right. That sounds like a very happy station. You are on with Jimmy Akin. What's your question?
Hi. Thank you, Jimmy, for taking my call. Sure. This is not as somber as the previous one.
Okay.
My question is, with all that we do to look at the planets and that sort of thing, mm-hmm. is there a chance, do you think, for intelligent life outside of our own species mm-hmm. on a distant planet? And if so, how would that relate to us as Christians, specifically Catholic Christians, mm-hmm. and what would God's relationship be to those people or beings?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. In terms of is there intelligent life other than human, the answer is yes, because there are angels. Angels are beings, they're alive in a spiritual sense, and they're intelligent. So we know God has made at least one other race of intelligent living beings besides us. Now, they're not biological life forms, and so they're not native to some planet somewhere. But since we already know that God has made one other form of intelligent life besides us, there's no reason he may not have made others. We already have, you know, two intelligent life forms that we know about, us and angels. So there could very well be more. At some point in the universe's history, maybe some others are living right now, maybe they're nearby, maybe they're not. We'll just have to wait and see. That's really a question of science rather than faith, although it's an interesting scientific question. In terms of what that would mean for the faith, well, it would mean God's made another group of intelligent beings, but it would leave a lot of questions unanswered. It would leave, for example, unanswered the question, are they fallen? You know, maybe their race didn't fall. If they are fallen, did God provide a means of redemption for them? If he did he provide it in a similar way to the way he redeemed us? Or might they be able to experience redemption through the means he provided for us? Could they be baptized and become Christians, you know, who receive the full range of sacraments the way we do? Or would God have made some other provision for them? All of those questions are ones that people have asked and have speculated about. In fact, there are a lot of science fiction stories that deal with this. A famous exploration of just these topics was written by C.S. Lewis in his series known as the Space Trilogy, where he has people going to Venus and Mars and encountering different societies that God made, including one that is on the verge of either having to make the decision to fall or not fall. And so you might check that out. There have been lots of other treatments of the same subjects. There's some famous examples. There's one called The Sparrow, which is about a Jesuit investigating other life on other planets. There's even an episode, we mentioned Star Trek earlier in the show, there's an episode called Bread and Circuses of the original series, where they find a kind of Roman society. And they keep hearing about all these sun worshipers in this Roman society, all these sun worshipers. And they're going, well, the Romans weren't that big on sun worship. And at the end of the episode, they find out it's not the sun in the sky they're worshiping. It's the Son of God. And so the implication is Jesus became incarnate on their planet too. So there's a lot of interesting food for thought there. But there's no way to answer those questions in advance. The church would have to study and figure out the situation as we encountered these different races. And so it's interesting to think about, but we really have to leave all those questions in God's hands until such time as he allows us to encounter such beings and start actually learning about them.
Thank you, Anonymous.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Sure thing.
And, you know, Walker Percy, in his book Lost in the Cosmos,
right? Yeah,
where the people who are not fallen realize that the earthlings are approaching, and they're like, no, stop, go back. We don't need you here. Thanks for coming. So they never do get to meet them. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. And continuing our outbreak of anonymity, we go to Anonymous in San Diego, California, listening on Immaculate Heart Radio. Anonymous, you are on with Jimmy Akin.
Yeah, my question is about the Holy Spirit. And if we get baptized in the Holy Spirit, if there is such a thing for today, like at the day of Pentecost, would our if our gift was speaking in tongues, would it be should it be another language, or would it just be babbling?
Okay, well, let's clarify some terminology first. The church, when it talks about baptism, always means the sacrament of baptism. And so even though there are some communities that use phrases like spirit baptism or baptism in the spirit or things like that. The church understands that fundamentally we receive the Holy Spirit in the sacrament of baptism. There are other ways we receive the Holy Spirit during the course of the Christian life, for example, in the sacrament of confirmation. And there are extra sacramental experiences of the Holy Spirit. So we even see those in Scripture, like where John in the book of Revelation more than once says, I was in the Spirit. And it's like he's had a sudden new experience of the Holy Spirit, even though he's not just received a sacrament. And so we receive the Holy Spirit many ways in our life. And even though in some communities they will use the term spirit baptism or baptism in the Spirit for some of those, it's not really a common term in Catholic theology. It's not one you'll find in official magisterial documents. Having said that, we do experience the Holy Spirit in a variety of ways, and sometimes that could manifest in a miraculous gift like speaking in tongues. In terms of what speaking in tongues is in the Bible, there are different viewpoints, and some exegetes will look at it, will look at the texts principally in the book of Acts and also in 1 Corinthians, and they'll say, well, it's kind of a miracle of hearing where even though I'm speaking in English, someone who's, say, a Spanish speaker will understand me even though I'm talking in English. And they point to the day of Pentecost as an example of that. But really, if you look closely at the evidence, this is my personal opinion, but I'm strongly convinced after a really extensive study I did of this, they're talking in other languages. So like even though they were native Aramaic speakers on the day of Pentecost, they weren't speaking in Aramaic. They were speaking in the languages that the crowd heard them speak in. So it's a miracle of speaking, not a miracle of hearing. That's why it's called speaking in tongues, not hearing in tongues. And the same thing is indicated in 1 Corinthians, that this is talking in another language, in another tongue. That's what the Greek word for language is. It's the same as the word for tongue, glossa. And so so this is speaking in another language. Now, having said that, that's the biblical reality. That's the gift they're talking about in the Bible. It's the miraculous speaking in a language you don't naturally know. But that doesn't limit God from being able to do other similar things later on in church history. And so when we read in church history, we'll find accounts of things that are like speaking in tongues, but not quite the same, that may involve a miracle of hearing rather than speaking or something like that. Having said that, also I'd point out the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith just recently published a document on charismatic gifts where they mentioned that the Holy Spirit is not constrained to just a specific set of spiritual gifts, let's say from the first century. He can give whatever gift is needed in a given time, and so it's not like we can limit that. So God could allow this gift to take different forms in different times, but the biblical version seems to be miraculously speaking a language you don't naturally know.
Thank you very much, Anonymous. Another hour of Open Forum coming up. Jimmy Akin will be with us for that hour as well. 888-318-7884 is the number. And as I said before, the lines do fill up quickly on these Open Forum days. So if you have any question at all about the life or faith of the Catholic Church, or about the life of faith in general, or the moral life, we're happy to take those questions. 888-318-7884. You can also find us on YouTube Live, Facebook Live, or Periscope, and submit your questions there if you prefer to do it that way. I am Cy Kellett. This is Catholic Answers Live. We'll be back in just a minute with more from Jimmy Akin and Open Forum.